several very important workshops this afternoon. I know some of we're really excited to have an opportunity to have presented to us. Under admin matters, not a whole lot going on. I'd like your we've got some options on tonight's agenda, and there are a couple items on consent that we could move potentially to action simply to enhance the public awareness of them if we think it's necessary. One is we are round one kicking off two new schools through the approval of the architectural and engineering services for Thoroughgood Elementary replacement and Princess Anne Middle School replacement. Kind of a big deal, and as one of your colleagues pointed out, yeah, and by the way, it's $5 million between the two. Maybe put it on action just to, you know, have the opportunity to discuss. It's the good news. We're moving forward with two new schools. Thoughts on that? Go ahead and move it or leave it on consent.
I think it's a good thing to move.
I think in terms of transparency and stuff, things like that. The other is we've got two easements where we're shifting small pieces of our campuses to. One is Dominion Power at College Park for a power easement, and the other is at John B. Dye. It's a drainage easement and a sidewalk easement, as I read it. Mm-hmm. But is Tony here or Dale? Is it a sidewalk at John B. Dye?
Drainage.
Turn.
What?
It's a turn lane.
Turn lane?
Yes.
Okay. Oh. Okay. All right.
It's a for Great Neck, but it's
right.
On John B. Dye's property.
Oh.
Okay. Right. Okay. Okay.
We had it originally listed during agenda planning as Great Neck easement.
Right.
But
okay,
it turns out it was actually on the property line for John B. Dye.
Okay. But I'm inclined to also put that on, just make people aware. I am a little concerned. The power easement at College Park, we have above ground utility issues there, like we had at Kempsville Middle or Kempsville Elementary a few years back. Pardon? Okay, all right. If you could, yeah. Well, unless there's objection, we'll put all that stuff on action. I think it's the appropriate thing from a transparency and disclosure standpoint.
Yes.
So thank you for the suggestion, Mrs. McLeod, particularly the A&E services. Other items relative to tonight, we've got a closed session that may occur this afternoon, may not, given the nature of the workshops we've got, and I suspect the interest level that we'll all have in the workshop. So we'll be prepared to do the closed afterwards if need be, and we could have the closed in three different locations. It could potentially be back down here. It could be, we could stay in the boardroom, or we could go to 113 since it's a closed session. Normally we'd go to 113. Is that okay with everybody? If it was a real quick 5 or 10 minute closed, it might be simpler to stay in the boardroom and do it. But I think it's the nature of that is probably, you know, we're going to have a little time to talk about it. So we'll plan on 113 for the closed, unless we actually get it done this afternoon, which, as I said, I'm not hopeful for. Beyond that, other items that you want to share with your colleagues briefly that are not committee reports that we would provide from the dais, anything that you've seen or that you want to share at this point?
I'd like to say something.
Yes, ma'am.
I would like to mention, when we are discussing things, especially on the dais when we're on camera, that we especially when you have emotional issues, it's very tempting to make comments or to have little side conversations. That happened last week, and I thought it was very distracting. And it's also disrespectful to the person who's trying to give their point of view. So I wish we would be, you know, conscious of that and be aware that that has happened more than once.
Okay. I think we should stay focused on whoever has the live mic at the time. That's a good comment. Mrs. Holtz, thank you. Mrs. Rye.
Yes, thank you. You can pass that down. Friday night, and Mrs. Anderson was the other board member in attendance, but at the Sandler Center was a community event, Suicide Awareness, Shatter the Silence. And it was the combined effort of many different community groups. And it was informative beyond words. A number of survivors spoke. And the main point why I'm bringing up here is, you know, the age level. And some of these survivors are high school students. And this problem that, for those of us who know that for decades colleges have been dealing with, you know, in more recent years is now coming down to the high school level. That was first brought to my attention, the magnitude of it, during the, at the Richmond School Board Summer Abbreviated Conference, a school district up in Northern Virginia, a high school dealing with 3 suicides last year. I was stunned beyond words. So I just look forward, moving forward to, I know there are things in place in our division, and maybe we can, as a board, collectively ask for a summary of it, because a number of these community groups have indicated, I don't have all the details, but they do come in and share, and, you know, I among others, would like to learn more.
Just to piggyback on that just for a little bit, on him here, you'll see Ronnie Sidney, the second author of Nelson Beats the Odds. Fantastic books that he's written for children to, and I thought it might be appropriate to pass that on to the Equity Council, because it really, it hit home with us. We were very impressed with that, and so I would highly recommend that Ronnie Sidney, author of Nelson Beats the Odds. He has 2 books actually right now that and the books are written sort of like cartoonish stylish, you know, to begin with, but definitely something that students would benefit from, and teachers actually would benefit from reading as well. So.
Mrs. Williams?
Kind of on the same lines, tomorrow I'll be in Norfolk meeting with a working task group of opioid addiction, and I'll be on the education group. Mark Herring will be there. It's being put on by the FBI, and it's regional. We'll be working on that for the next year. Also, we'll be going to California and be presenting some stuff that Virginia's doing. And we've beefed up our curriculum, and maybe we can get a report on that at the same time, as far as opioids in our middle school PE, health and PE curriculum, thanks to Amy Castro and her group. So again, just trying to make sure that our school kids and our parents get all the information they need on the opioids and painkillers. And so I'll keep y'all updated on that, but that happens tomorrow morning.
Thank you for that. Mrs. Felton?
I just wanted to say I had the opportunity to sit in with the high school principal of the City of Virginia Beach Public Schools, and I'd like to say that Chief Judge Tanya Bullock gave an insightful presentation on juveniles and the relationship between schools, and giving the principals the opportunity to talk and ask questions about prevention matters. I think she's scheduled to be back again on the 29th. I hope that it'll be something else that I'd be able to sit in on. But it was an insightful conversation with Chief Judge Tanya Bullock.
Okay. Anybody else? Okay. Mrs. Taylor will be joining us here. She had some medical appointments that, as she indicated, not all doctors adhere to their schedules, so she's going to be joining us at some time after our start here. And the last thing is, I am passing around, this is the teacher forum is having their initial meeting of the year next Monday. We'll pass this around, and if you can get to the meeting to join with them next Monday, you're certainly welcome to do that. And please let them know either way. It would be helpful for them to know that. So With that, Dr. Spence, you want to move forward with the first workshop?
I do. Let me just quickly note, we will follow up on those comments and we'll get the board a memo about our efforts around suicide prevention and awareness and around our efforts around embedding curriculum, what we're doing around opioid awareness and prevention, those issues. And we'll pass along the Nelson Beats the Odds reference for our, particularly for our school counselors. So we'll do that as well. Okay. Not too long ago, we were talking at length about looking at our special education programming, indicated to the board that we would be conducting an evaluation, getting a third-party group to come in and do that with us. And that has been done, and as I indicated recently, we'll be workshopping on that. So that's what tonight is all about, taking a look at our special ed programs through the eyes of a lens of an evaluation of those programs. And hopefully we'll be able to convey through that our response to some of the data that we've been looking at and talking about. So we look forward to that tonight. And to do that, to kick us off, is Dr. Cashwell. So.
Good evening. Good evening, Chairman Edwards, Vice Chair Anderson, Dr. Spence, and School Board members. You may recall that last year we reorganized the Office of Programs for Exceptional Children under Dr. Valika Gatling, Executive Director, rather. Now serves for Office of Programs for Exceptional Children, which brought together our gifted services and our special education services under the same office. That alignment has really allowed us to strengthen our services to schools and to students, and has also increased our ability to collaborate, particularly when it comes to our students who are twice exceptional. So we've been really pleased with the way that alignment has enabled the work that we've been able to do with our schools. So one thing that was recognized early on by Dr. Gatling and her team shortly following the realignment was a need for a longer term or a longer range plan regarding our special education services. And I'm pleased to announce that we're on track with that. You'll hear later in the presentation from Evergreen that one of their recommendations centers around this need for a long-term plan. So you may be wondering, if we're on track, then why commission the audit? We commissioned the audit to really carefully analyze services as we're currently providing them to students, and also help us identify opportunities for growth and improvement. We were really interested to know what those areas might be. And so to provide more information regarding the audit, and then following that, Dr. Gatling will share an administrative response. I have Dr. Kim Kavanaugh, Senior Programs Director, Consultant from Evergreen, wanted to carefully title her there. She's done an outstanding job with Evergreen on conducting the audit, and she's here to provide you with a full presentation that goes over the audit process and findings. And then, as I said, Dr. Gatling will share an administrative response, and then the three of us will be available to answer any questions you might have, not only regarding the audit itself, but regarding those next steps for moving forward that Dr. Gatling is going to share with you this evening. All right, Dr. Kavanaugh.
Hello. Thank you so much for giving us the opportunity to give this overview of the evaluation that we did. The document itself is fairly mammoth, I think we can say. So tonight you're going to kind of get the brief summary view, and you'll have an opportunity at another time to go through in more detail. So tonight we're just going to talk a little bit about the scope of the review, the methodology, spend a little more time on the commendations and recommendations, and then, as she said, have an opportunity for questions and answers. Before I start talking about exactly what we've done, I think it's important to point out that while this was done as an evaluation of the Virginia Beach City Public Schools special education program, specifically under the auspices of the Office of, for Programs for Exceptional Children, it really, what you're going to find as you look through the full evaluation, it's really difficult to keep within the discrete topics that we addressed. The topics were identified for a reason. They are some of the key components and the driving factors in special education. That said, there's a whole lot of interweaving within those topics. And so when I go through some of the findings, You might be thinking, well, that sounds a little familiar. That interweavingness is perhaps one of the strongest themes that you're going to see when you go through the evaluation itself. There are very few bright lines in education, and I think just listening to you talking about this activities that you've been participating in, you have a real clear vision of that. There aren't any bright lines in special education. There are even fewer. Everything is sort of a gray area. We know that the core of special education is that concept of free, appropriate public education offered to students in the least restrictive environment. Every one of those factors up there influences FAPE and the LRE. They influence each other. They interact with each other in multiple ways. Staffing and organization impact service delivery models as well as decisions about professional development. Service delivery models and teacher preparedness drives your student outcomes. The way funds are allocated, the priorities that are reflected in those allocations influence just about everything. The amount and quality of supports that are available for your students as well as the supports that are available for your staff. This braiding of topics is, as I said, evident throughout this report, but it's also evident in every school building that you go into. The second, and I think the most important theme that comes through in this report, is that all means all. We know that good teaching is effective with all kinds of students, whether they be students with disabilities, English language learners, other students who are just struggling temporarily with a given set of skills or content, as well as gifted students or students who are excelling in one or more areas. While we include recommendations throughout this evaluation for disaggregating and analyzing your data specific to your students with disabilities, it's also imperative to remember that within this district, first and foremost, every student with a disability is a member of your all students group. Subgroups are important, but your all students group is where the hard work really has to happen, is really going to be done. These two themes of the braidedness, the interconnectedness of the topics that influence special education programs, and the idea that the students we're talking about are first and foremost members of your all students population, lead to a caution about the tendency of organizations sometimes to experience what we call the silo effect. As a way of work, a response to pressure is to go to my specialist, go to my expert, go to other people who are where I am and ask for their help and ask for their guidance. Remembering that schools are full of amazing classrooms with lots of messy little children and big children and messy teachers and different personalities and different issues and different problems. And silos will not be the place that you find those solutions. So that's this little cautionary statement as we go forward. With regard to what did we actually do while we were here to come up with that mammoth report, first there was a diagnostic review conducted in April. It was a shorter visit. We did mostly district level interviews and data diving, trying to just to get ideas from the district level about what's really going on and what you see, what they saw as some of the primary issues. Then we engaged in a significant amount of data collection and analysis. We did the peer school division comparisons because we want to make sure that we were able to give you information about where this division is in comparison with the local similarly situated schools. We did a staff ESE survey. We were very impressed with the percentage of stakeholders, ESE stakeholders that responded. Can't do the math that quickly, but about 40 to 45%, which is pretty good for a survey response.
Mm-hmm. Very good.
And a lot of anecdotal responses. We always provide open-ended, and the amount of information, people poured their hearts out, I would say. Your staff poured their hearts out. In a very, very thoughtful way in response to this. And the parent surveys also of that approximately 1,000 responses. And then the week of May 2nd, we were here and brought a team of five consultants, revisited many of those district level staff to delve deeper and to be a little more discreet in our analysis, and also to go into the schools and do some focus groups with front-end service providers. Just if anybody cares, there's nothing on this screen anymore, so if I can look up here.
Oh.
I thought it was going up there too. So, first of all, the organization and staffing of special education. Obviously, I think this is very clear. I think you've all experienced this. Our first commendation was Dr. Gatling's approach to management, supervision, and communication within the division. This was heard loud and clear in school buildings across individuals from every occupation group, as well as at the district the division level. And very strong relationships among staff, students, and families. This is one of the brains. This came up in every topic area that we talked about was, and once we got into the schools, really seeing it firsthand, those relationships were very compelling. As far as recommendations, there were, I think there's 15 recommendations in this area. Some of them involved minor changes to organizational structure and formalizing procedures. Particularly, one had to do with co-locating all of the exceptional children staff into one space to sort of continue that work with communication and close supervision that Dr. Gatling has started. And then increasing professional learning communities and collaborative planning opportunities. This is critical. It is a resource commitment, so it taps onto the fiscal piece as well, because professional learning and collaborative planning takes time and takes human bodies spending that time. So there's an impact there, but it's very supportive both of students with disabilities and interdisciplinary curriculum and interdisciplinary lesson planning, which is going to benefit all of your students. We also have a series of recommendations related to establishing or revising existing guidelines related to things like special education teacher assignments, co-teaching teams, use of paraprofessionals, therapist workloads versus caseloads. The roles and responsibilities of assistant principals and program compliance support teachers. I don't want to go into a lot of detail here, but this is one of the places where things were very different from school to school, and in many, many schools there was a lot of stepping on toes between what those roles and responsibilities are. And so one of the things that we talked about was ways to formalize their roles and responsibilities and perhaps provide a little more structure and consistency, in particular for the program compliance support teachers, to make them be a more valuable resource for you. The bullet number one, special education teacher assignments, that dealt with things as diverse as the number of students that each teacher is responsible for, particularly special education teachers. I'll say it was very interesting to note that the single most frequently offered suggestion was, we need more special education teachers, which I will say was a surprise to me, because when we look at your numbers compared to other divisions in the state and districts in other states, your teachers have very reasonable caseloads. Then we started delving into it, things a little bit further within the schools and within the teacher focus groups. And that's where we discovered that it wasn't really that they were asking for more teachers. They were asking for more reasonable types of caseloads, for more logical assignments of duties, not necessarily more bodies. Because when we say, what will you do with more bodies? I don't know. The number of grades, teachers being responsible for being a curriculum specialist for 3 or 4 grade levels was too challenging. 3 or 4 subjects across multiple grade levels, it's now become, I might have 12 students, but if I'm responsible for 3 or 4 grade levels, that's where it becomes untenable. And then some of the expectations for the types of classes and students that teachers would be teaching, was also made their jobs more challenging. With regard to the quality and effectiveness of special education teacher pedagogy, this is really the do my teachers have the capacity, the skills, knowledge, and ability, physical resources, and time to do the things that they're being asked to do, whether they came into the district from a college preparation program or whether it's the professional learning opportunities that are provided here. So what we found was that within the division, there's an immense amount of professional learning opportunities that are available to all teachers, and that a significant amount of it is focused on the needs of students with disabilities. As I said before, I cannot understate how impressed we were with the commitment and professionalism of your special education teachers. To hear teachers in groups where usually they're vent fests, and instead they were talking about the things they do to hone their craft. I do this a lot. I don't hear teachers use that phrase that often, but more than one teacher did. They see themselves, it's a craft, and it's a something that they've committed their lives to. One teacher went out of her way to explain that she's not a teacher, she's an educator, and her job is to educate children, to educate colleagues, to educate families. It's very impressive. You have an amazing wealth of resources right there. Using those resources, some of our recommendations include enhancing the professional learning that you have in place now through cross-disciplinary planning and implementation. Things like participation requirements, the teacher that I was talking about, you're supposed to keep updated on curriculum. Okay, I teach third grade math, fourth grade math, fifth grade math, and I teach it with two different teachers. So on the day that I go for my curriculum update, do I go to the third grade or the fourth grade or the fifth grade? They talked about the things that they came up with. One common solution was we pick the grade that's being tested, and that's the one we go to. Logical answer, logical decision, but clearly it's sending a message that what's important is that test, and maybe not so much making sure that the teachers have the skills that they need to get the children there. Changing the roles and responsibilities of general and special education teachers. This shows up again in some of the service delivery model, FAPE and the LRE sections. Understanding that because all means all, a child who's in a classroom all day long belongs to that classroom teacher just as much as that child belongs to their special education teacher or a paraprofessional. And then enhancing opportunities for job-embedded professional learning, that opportunity to, for whether it's administrators or teachers, to really hone those skills in place, in their jobs, as part of an applied learning process, rather than a going off to a day of listening. The next area that we looked at was outcomes for students with disabilities, which is really what the whole thing is all about. And some of the commendations, there were lots. There were more than I can attempt to go over. But some of the highlights were the videos that have been developed by the Department of Teaching and Learning on assessments. There were speech and language pathologists have done some classroom embedded project work in some of the schools that was very impressive. There are quite impressive job-related experiential opportunities for your students with significant disabilities. It was very notable. It's in most places it is the students with the more significant cognitive disabilities for whom those job opportunities, we actually have special projects, but the focus on an inclusive community within this city as well as an inclusive school district was very impressive. and then collaboration within the division and with neighboring divisions that was brought up and discussed through various of our interviews were all very commendable. Recommendations included things like addressing the staffing issues. There's one significant one is the recommendation to reinstate the transition coordinator position, having high school teachers doing some of the follow-up work and the things that they're doing. It's useful, but transition coordinator is a very unique out there in the community kind of a position that really would warrant a dedicated slot. And then re-envisioning the roles, responsibilities, and staffing decisions for general and special educators at different school levels. I just kind of laughed because that's sort of kind of big. Like, we go from this one thing, a position, to really rethink what your general ed teachers and your special ed teachers are doing with these students. And it will look different in elementary school versus middle school versus high school. And it should look different. Include OPEC in the monitoring and interventions with the tiered schools. All means all works both directions. Besides the fact that that office has an amazing amount of expertise in the area of working with challenging students, they also have a lot of students in those tiered schools that are getting the attention, and they should be part of that process. And then formalizing the expectations for division-wide outcomes for students with disabilities. This is that focus on actually disaggregating the data and coming up with a plan for everything from academic outcomes to decreasing dropout rate, to increasing graduation rate, to increasing enrollment in post-secondary programs and obtaining employment. Next big area was provision of FAPE in the special education program. Again, the commendation is based on the culture of inclusion and the focus on community-based learning opportunities that we saw everywhere that we went. And the ongoing progress that you have been implementing, that you have been seeing in increasing student performance. We just understand that you're not quite where you want to be yet. Our recommendations include establishing a division-operated cluster sites to support students with more significant or resource-intensive needs. And this involves some of the CSEP programs that we were looking at, and it wasn't an all CSEP programs kind of a thing, but it was if a student is in general education classrooms in the school building for half or more of that school day, then it would be logical that that student would be able to be actually enrolled in that school building. That would be their home school. And there were a lot of programs that reported that if they'd had maybe an autism specialist or a DHH specialist, deaf, hard of hearing specialist, that clustering students in a program like that would be more fiscally less of an impact on the district. Expanding service delivery models used to support inclusion, and we're going to talk about that a little bit in a minute, that there's a lot more opportunities than just co-teaching for supporting those students. And then creating and supporting a seamless multi-tiered system of supports across all of the division schools. Work is currently being done to strengthen the multi-tier system of supports, or MTSS, you'll hear it called, with regard to social-emotional development throughout the division. There's the positive behavioral supports projects and that work that's being done. Applying that same level of scrutiny to academic outcomes of students with disabilities through a tiered approach to evaluating core instruction, supplemental interventions, and intensive individualized interventions will enable your school and your district, your division leadership, to hone in on exactly what is working or is not working and for which subgroups, and to make adjustments as needed. And that was a piece of that, the detailed data drilling and data analysis that we didn't quite see happening. Who was it? Peter Drucker, I think, who said what gets two versions. One was what gets measured gets done, or what gets measured gets improved. That kind of makes me unhappy, but it kind of is true. And so it just is true. And taking the time to engage in that kind of data analysis and planning, I guarantee you will increase your outcomes. Other recommendations with regard to the FAPE question involved increasing or creating more formal collaborative agreements with early childhood partners within the community. Least restrictive environment for pre-kindergarten age children is one of the biggest challenges districts face, because usually you don't have a bunch of classes of typically developing 3 or 4 year olds. But there are a lot of opportunities for push-in services through collaborative agreements with early childhood partners. And the best way to get a child included in kindergarten is to have that child come out of an inclusive pre-kindergarten program. The biggest challenge is to come from a separate special education pre-kindergarten program and try to convince a kindergarten teacher that inclusion is the way to go. That's a difficult argument to make sometimes. Expand and enhance the current training that you're doing on inclusion, including opportunities for curriculum, instruction, and service delivery models. There's a lot of folklore and tradition at the school level, I will tell you. We've heard things that seemed unusual, and when I would bring the questions back to the district and say, do you not have a this? Here it is, here it is, here it is, on the website, click here, click here, click here. The information is here, the resources are here. The school buildings are not so aware that some of those tools are there with regard to curriculum, service delivery options, the gamut. So there needs to be a focus on that. Establishing guidelines regarding the ratio of students with disabilities and non-disabled peers in inclusive gen ed courses. The recommendation nationally is never more than 25% to 33% of the students in a class should be students with IEPs. You have some classrooms out there where it's 50, 60%. And that's going to be too high of a hill for that general ed teacher as well as for the special ed teacher. And then review the process for identifying and clearly articulating the services, the specially designed instruction a student needs to meet his or her unique needs. It sounds like an odd thing, but it's reflective of this. Everyone, the services that are being provided continue to be the services that were provided, and those were based on what was provided, which is, so it's like this, mm-hmm. It just keeps on happening, it keeps on happening. If everybody says stop, let's not look at our menu, let's look at the kid, exactly what does he need, then that's going to be more likely to break out of that cycle and start coming up with more unique ideas for how to meet those needs. Okay. Cost analysis. Commendations. Okay. Commendations were made regarding the process, the collaborative process for preparing your annual application for your IDEA funds, and for the handling of legal matters, IDEA, the special education, and Section 504 legal matters through using in-house legal staff. A lot of districts drown in their outside legal fees because of these kinds of concerns. Recommendations include implementing procedures to validate purchases made with designated special education funds. Again, it's kind of related to what gets counted. It's, you know, if I'm not looking at it, if I'm not asking you to prove to me where that money came from, it's easy for things to get a little flexible. This is not an area you want to be gray. Money, there should be bright lines. Just so. And then reviewing the current relationship with CSAP, including the criteria for referring and placing students and the contractual arrangements between the parties. There was some confusion when we were here in the spring that was being worked on at that time, just about how that process was working. Other recommendations included trying to rebuild your annual carry forward there was a while when things were kind of flush. This happened everywhere. It's a local thing, but it was also a national economy kind of a thing. But trying to rebuild that carry forward to be a better buffer. The third bullet is important in a number of ways. Involving relevant school-based staff members when IDEA or Section 504 complaints are filed, including the implementation of corrective action when required. Well, this falls under, it showed up under the fiscal section because it was observed. It came up as part of the budget, the money that's being spent to deal with these things and how are they being managed. From a more programmatic side, I will tell you from experience that when a school administration and the teachers are the people who have to deal with resolving the problem and in doing all of the corrective action, including bearing the costs of those corrective actions, hardly ever do they make the same mistake twice. It's just a thing that happens. And then another area that we strongly recommended that you look at was the division procedures for responding to school-based requests for temporary educational assistance and other staff augmentation. This is one of those interesting points because there's also a commendation for the level of responsiveness that OPIC has when a school reaches out and says, we need help. They're very responsive in helping them get additional staff. The downside is, then sometimes you're digging a hole that you can't really afford to dig. And then reviewing and revising the current special education transportation procedures. And transportation is often one of it is the big budget line item in most schools' budget, most district budgets. As far as the record keeping system, the commendations include the use of the Synergy Special Education, which is your centralized management system. There's whether it's a written policy or an informal policy, I'm not sure, but in federal law, there's a thing called prior written notice, and Virginia Beach provides prior written notice with every IEP to ensure that parents have been provided all of the information that is required and are fully informed of what's happening. Virginia being a strongly consent state with regard to the services on the IEP, it's particularly critical that parents have that information. So while in some cases it may be overkill, it may not be necessary, it's always an excellent idea. And then you have very robust parent participation policies, and schools understand what the expectations are for getting parents to participate in those meetings. Our recommendations include ensuring that ample time is provided during meetings for thorough discussion and vetting of ideas. I can tell you there's a disconnect between district policy about a recommended length of time and what some school buildings are allowing for schedules. And so increasing some of that allowed time. When you think a family's coming in, by the time you do introductions, you're a few minutes in and 20 minutes isn't going to be sufficient. Consider facilitated IEP team meetings to provide more focused, positive, and productive use of time. This is something that school-based staff and district-based staff can be trained in, and it's really just sort of the use of a semi-independent person who's just able to keep the meeting going and parking lotting the distractors, and it's been proven to be very effective. And then enhancing guidance to teams regarding the intent and implementation of standards-based IEPs. Teachers' frustration and anxiety over what they think they're supposed to be doing when they provide specially designed instruction really came out in this discussion. Because it turns out that indeed they are being given guidance on how to bridge the gap between where a child is and where the child is supposed to be. But they're missing that part, and they feel that they aren't really allowed to be bridging that gap, that they're supposed to only be teaching up here. And it really came out in the IEP discussions. The last area was the development and functionality of the Special Education Advisory Committee. Commendations included the use of the new member orientation packets to make sure that people coming on the board really understand what's happening, how it functions, the community resource fair, hosting the Disabilities History and Awareness Month, those kinds of activities. First recommendation was to develop a plan to formalize the procedures and comply with roles and responsibilities. It's really just strengthen the structure and make sure that those, you know, the structures and procedures are put in place for a reason, and sometimes it's easy to get a little lax. So really, you know, standing a little more firm on those and conducting an annual self-assessment to determine, you know, are we really doing what we see our vision to be? And then expanding membership to other parents and other community agency representatives to get a broader view of who the community is and who should be on that committee. All right, and now I'm going to turn it over to Dr. Gatling for her administrative response.
Thank you, Dr. Cavanaugh. As you know, we have a comprehensive special education program that spans our 86 schools and centers. We provide services to more than 7,800 students with disabilities, so we thank Evergreen for its thorough review. We commissioned the audit last spring to inform our work moving forward, most notably to help us with the development of a five-year plan of our division special education program. We seek to continuously improve how we support the progress of our and achievement of our students with disabilities, as well as our staff who work with them. And we knew that an impartial third party would help to guide us. We appreciate Evergreen's commendations for our good work, and we celebrate those and the work of our teachers, who on a daily basis do an awesome job for our children. However, we are especially grateful for receiving recommendations on how to improve our organization, our services, our efficiency, and we also appreciate the support of our colleagues and other departments and offices who help us to further these recommendations. We are pleased to see that in many places we are already moving in the right direction as the audit suggested. In the slides that will follow, I will share what we've already done and how we're connecting the pieces and making progress, and how this audit will serve as a foundation of our five-year plan. I noted that Evergreen's work was thorough, and you just heard a sampling of the commendations and recommendations in these eight areas. Next, I'll share with you some progress already made in several of these areas, which align and support recommendations from many of these eight audit areas. In Evergreen's review of staffing and organization of special education, it was recommended that we employ a financial analyst be employed to facilitate the management and accountability of our funding sources. This has been accomplished. We hired an analyst in August. In the same area, it was recommended that we revise the staffing structure of our speech and language pathologists. Again, this has already happened. This revision was necessary to ensure equitable scheduling and caseloads of our staff. In the area of quality and effectiveness of special education teacher pedagogy, the Evergreen Solutions recommended that we enhance our professional learning through cross-disciplinary planning and implementation, and that the work that we've already done is aligned, and we've started with a collaboration with our professional growth and innovation department to support, develop, and implement professional learning opportunities with the potential to influence the special education programs and outcomes for our students with disabilities. During the summer at our administrators conference, we launched self-guided, self-paced, embedded modules around the topics of facilitating inclusive environments and specially designed instruction. These modules have been well received because staff now have a one-stop shop to common vocabulary and knowledge around these two important topics. We're looking forward to adding additional modules to the modules as the year progresses. In Evergreen's review of our outcomes for students with disabilities, they recommended that we include identify key professional learning experiences that are critical for the achievement of our students. This summer, instructional specialists worked with the academic support coordinator to review the components of one of our literacy programs that assists students and supporting students who are struggling readers, as well as looking at the reporting components that will help our teachers to inform instructional planning. Also in alignment with the area of outcomes for students with disabilities, we had our first meeting of CSEP directors and special education directors from local school divisions on September 2nd. During that meeting, we focused on ways to improve outcomes for students, as well as how to have clear and effective communication with all of our parents. And lastly, in alignment with Evergreen's review of outcomes with students with disabilities, OPEC has worked with the Department of Student Leadership to ensure that each school will place an emphasis on closing achievement gaps with an intentional focus on achievement gaps for students with disabilities. Beginning this school year, the school improvement process meetings that are held regularly at each school will have an improvement goal to address performance of students with disabilities and also will monitor the progress regularly. Our OPEC staff will work alongside with schools through the school improvement process meetings to provide necessary support structures for schools as they work on their particular goals. Even before the audit was solicited, staff and OPEC, we recognized the need to put in place a comprehensive multi-year plan to ensure that our program was operating at its best and meeting the needs of our students and families. Thus, we began mobilizing efforts to make progress in several areas. Several of these improvements were shared with you on the prior slide. Evergreen also recommended that we develop a comprehensive plan addressing the recommendations in the study with a specific emphasis on the achievement of our students with disabilities with specific timelines and accountability. The audit that has been conducted and the accompanying recommendations will serve as a springboard in the future development of a five-year plan that will be created with the input of various stakeholder groups. It will allow us to hear directly from our students, our parents, our teachers, our administrators, and our advocates, and our organizations such as SEAC. My team and I are very excited about the opportunity to chart the course to increase outcomes for students with disabilities. This comprehensive multi-year plan will be structured in a five-year plan format similar to our local plan for the education of gifted, which the board reviewed and approved during our 15-16 school year. This school year will mark the formal beginning of the plan development, with the final plan being brought to the board in June. You may note on the slide that we'll begin our progress. We'll get underway in November when teams will be created for areas to be addressed within the plan. In December, our staff will be trained on how to facilitate the entire five-year planning process by leading teams and engaging stakeholders in team meetings. During the January-April timeframe, our teams will work to create objectives, activities, persons responsible, due dates, and expected results for each area of our plan. After the teams have completed their work, we'll come together in May and we'll synthesize the information and create a final plan. Finally, the plan will be presented to SEAC and also will be shared with our school board. Before we invite you for questions, I'd like to invite Dr. Cashwell back to bring closure to our presentation this evening.
Thank you, Dr. Gatling. Thank you again, Dr. Kavanaugh, for your Evergreen's thorough and very comprehensive review for the accommodations and recommendations. And thank you also, Dr. Gatling, for your leadership in OPEC and for your work alongside Evergreen to facilitate the audit process. I know there were, as you heard, throughout the lengthy audit process that involved a lot of time, not only from school staff, but from OPEC staff as well. So a special thank you to everyone who worked also in other departments across the school division to make sure all the information was provided to Evergreen in a timely manner. So in closing this presentation this evening, I want to emphasize how proud I am of our Virginia Beach City Public School special educators, those within our Office for Programs for Exceptional Children and those who work at the school level. Their dedication and commitment was not only highlighted as a commendation by Evergreen, but it's something that's noticeable every day when I'm visiting classrooms and when our staff's visiting. And so I just want to let you know how very proud we are of that continued work. And I'm also proud of that strong system of supports we have outside of our VBCPS family, that we have in our SEAC, that we have with our advocates, and our other organizations that support and lift up OPEC and the work that we do in our city. And several of them are present tonight, so I just want to acknowledge their presence. And again, thank you for working alongside us. We've got several coordinators and staff from OPEC here. We have SEAC members, advocates, and more. So thank you for being here and for your continued support as we chart our way forward. So as proud as we are of the commendations that we've received and of the work we see happening in our schools every day, I think we can all acknowledge that along with our strengths, we have challenges. You all have been aware of those challenges, as we have, that are inherent to delivering a strong program to our students with disabilities. And so that's why we initiated this audit. And we're pleased to have some very specific outlines for recommendations moving forward, and are really looking forward to being able to engage stakeholders, as was mentioned, through that five-year planning process. But that doesn't mean we're waiting till the development of the plan to move forward, as you saw. This is we have a sense of urgency around this work. The collective group within OPEC and across the division have already really begun to dig in and make sure that we're making things happen for our students, and that we're focusing on these areas for growth and improvement right away, but also that we have a very purposeful plan for moving forward and monitoring those results over the next 5 years. So we'll look forward to sharing more of those with you. So at this time, we're prepared to answer any questions you may have. I'm going to let you all move forward. So any questions we can answer for the board, even if, about the audit process or the administrative response?
Mrs. Williams?
One quick question. When will we be able to actually get the report so that we can read it?
You have
a mammoth report.
Yes, you were provided the executive summary. Because even that's lengthy, but we can get you a copy of the report as soon as you'd like it. So if we just, we'll just plan on getting that to you. You have your choice of an electronic or hard copy we can provide you. Happy to do either, and Diane's prepared to help facilitate that.
Okay, thank you. Thank you so much for getting this audit. You know, several of us have been passionate about this for years, and it makes me so happy. I'm not going to ask any questions because I want to read. It's so comprehensive and it's such a big deal, but I think definitely it's leading us in the right direction. Just some comments that I read that I really like. I love the stop looking at the menu, look at the kid and what the kid really needs. I love the professional development to make more clear the roles and responsibilities of everybody, the transition coordinators, the facilitated IEPs, look at expanding the service delivery models, and the guidelines. This is a huge one that we've been talking about, the guidelines for the ratio of how many IEP students you have in a regular ed class. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, I love the cluster sites, because I believe I brought this up one time and the lawyer about had a heart attack. But I know mine was not as quite like this, but I love the idea of the cluster sites as being what where the resources are intensified and the needs are great, to really, really concentrate on that. So a lot of exciting things. And again, I want to echo thank you everybody in the room who really works hard for the challenges of these students. We have a great story as my personal, my third child through Thurgood Independence and Hermitage, and then Bayside High School. This has been a great success because of just great special ed and general ed teachers that worked together with him for 11 years of him taking advantage of our special education, and he's doing great. Just had his second child the other day. Mm-hmm. So I have great stories about that. But it's a huge deal. I've been waiting for this. I've been waiting for a Cadillac version of special ed, and I think that's what we're heading for, just the best special ed department and how we can get there reasonably And I'm looking forward to reading it. And I will read that mammoth report, and then I'll have a lot more questions. But thank you so much for all your hard work and for doing this and making this a reality here. Thank you.
Mrs. Rye.
Yes, I certainly echo all those sentiments. I have a question for our consultant, Dr. Kavanaugh. Going back to the teacher survey, the close to 50%, how do you compare that with other divisions? Because, of course, we're so used to seeing, you know, we're happy to see 20% with teacher surveys. And I think we all realize it speaks volumes as to the commitment of our teachers, but if you could shed further light on that.
It does. And I wish I knew the magic bullet, because we do these evaluations all over the place. And it was unprecedented. And so, you know, we're like, okay, what did you guys, did you send the lollipop? And I will say that the folklore and tradition is that you get a higher response rate the angrier the people are. Mm. And there wasn't a lot of anger. There was frustration bubbled through, but every bit of frustration was balanced, usually by that same person, with a very positive message. So I don't know why it was so great. And they were very thoughtful, very detailed, very, you know, here's an idea. We could do this, not just venting, which is usually what we get.
But I want to personally thank publicly all the special ed teachers mm-hmm. for the time they did put into these responses. I think we would all concur with that.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Mrs. McLeod.
Thank you. This was very informative. I'll let Carolyn read the entire thing. I'll read the summary. But I had a couple of notes, and some of the things that Carolyn and Carolyn both said. The ratio, I have huge concerns, so I look forward to how we resolve that. I love the don't look at the menu, look at the kid. Super smart. You should, like, copyright that. The other part, too, is our teachers, when they're choosing professional leadership, it's concerning when they have multiple. I taught a second through grade class one time, so I understand that. Which training do you go to? And you brought up a very valid point, and I don't like that it's test-driven, so I hope that we help that. But my big question here is the reinstating transition coordinator positions. My question is, I don't know when, if, or how many we had. Were these in every school? And when do they go away, and what is the norm for school divisions in having these?
My understanding, this was not a section that I was involved in, my understanding it was not a school-based position. We're talking about district-level transition coordinators, which are the people that go out and beat the bushes and develop the relationships and identify effective programs. It's very labor-intensive, mm-hmm. and it's very challenging for teachers to make those kind of inroads. Most districts commonly have, at the district level, a transition. A district this size would have a couple of people who were secondary transition specialists, perhaps some working with significantly impaired students,
okay.
and others working with the real black hole is lower performing, typically developing students, the really LD kids, the mm-hmm. kids whose their academic achievement is okay, but the behaviors, the impulse control, things like that are really impeding their performance. Those are often the hardest students to find employment opportunities for. Mm-hmm. And so there's, from our experience, there's usually district staff who are dedicated to that, which goes into that silo thing that I tell you don't do, but it is a level of expertise it is giving you a person to be the go-to person to understand and to know the please and the wares out there in the community mm-hmm. and to help grow the programs.
Do we have anything community-based? Where I grew up, we had Gateway Services, and that's what they did. They came in and helped our students. It wasn't a position, it was a nonprofit. Is there anything in Virginia Beach like that I'm not familiar with? Because obviously I'm asking the question.
We do have several, we have numerous community-based instruction opportunities for students.
I mean, I know Eagleston and those kind of things, but I'm talking about really trying to find the job part of it. And that's...
We do.
Okay.
Yes.
All right. Mm-hmm. And we're utilizing that resource. Yes. So while we don't have it in-house,
right.
there are resources available to us.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
Mrs. Anderson?
I just want to commend you for this analysis and for this study, and commend ourselves, because I feel like we're on the track to making some needed changes. And also that we've already gone to work on some of those changes that have been recommended.
Mrs. Felton?
I'd just like to say thank you, Dr. Gallen and Dr. Cashwell, for this deep, intel presentation. And I'd like to commend you for stepping in and running with the mantle at times that has been very challenging moments. And I'm looking forward to having this conversation as you move forward in your progression in this process, because I'm liking the change and the enhancement that you're talking about. And it would especially give us more substance of conversation that we can have with our parents. And I like that it is hitting on transparency with the parents and hitting on those things about IEPs and the freight. I am excited about that. I am looking forward to this conversation and looking for greater things to come. We've had some challenges outside with parents and with the division, but I'm looking that this is going to be a great conversation to have. And thank you again for all that you've, and your staff, for all that you've done. Thank you.
Mrs. Rock.
I just had a little postscript. I feel I was remiss not also acknowledging the parents who took the time to respond. And while the number of 1,000 may not, you know, be as much of a wow factor as the teachers, let's all be reminded what the life of a special ed parent is. And, you know, the fact that we had that many parents find the time to do this, we say thank you.
Yes.
Right. Indeed.
The only thing I wanted to comment on was the involvement of the peer review. This is, you know, this wasn't a case where we just hired a vendor to come in here and share their expertise, but the concept of bringing in the best and brightest from a half a dozen or so school divisions in the region and throughout the state, including Fairfax County and stuff, was excellent.
And, and I think too, sort of a special thanks to that group, because they did not have to provide the information that we asked, and they stepped up, in some cases making a personal request for them to do that, because we needed to know. And so it was really good of those school divisions to work with us. It's a good example of that kind of collegiality in the state, so we're appreciative.
Great. Thank you. And as Mrs. Williams alluded to, we look forward to the following chapters in this.
Kind of like I'm sitting at the adult table.
Need big chairs. Sure.
Mm-hmm.
Gotcha. That chair needs to be. That chair needs to be shut. The one that Betsy was just in that she got rid of. That chair over there. See that chair that Betsy put over there.
Right.
Got the chair to be chucked.
I saw that.
I'm back.
Way down. Oh, okay.
Yeah. Well, don't go up or down anymore.
Go down and put a sticky on it.
I'm like, yeah. I can't not
get somehow it. Doesn't get back into the herd.
I know.
I mean, the forecast should be pretty good. Who knows?
I understand. How
much is it?
20 minutes.
No, I'm with you. Okay.
And I guess it was.
And I have
taken you know, I don't think that's going to work. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right, we're anxious to get an update on our construction projects. Welcome, Mr. Arnold.
Good afternoon, Mr. Chairman, members of the board, Dr. Spence. It's been several months, so we're excited to share with you guys where we are on all of our capital projects, large and the smaller stuff that that we're finishing up in this summer. The Old Donation School project, we're approaching 90% complete. It's, in fact, I went by there yesterday. I do this for a living. It's still fascinating to me. You know, if you're not by there for 4, 5, 6 weeks to see the changes, and so we're really starting to see the building come together from a finished perspective, and I think you see that as you drive by on the exterior. It's really a great building. Project's on budget, a little bit ahead of schedule. We were scheduled to move in September of 2017. We're very confident we're going to get in there in April. Exact date to be determined, but we have our first move meeting scheduled in about 2 weeks with Kelly Hedrick and some of our internal customers. So project's going really well. Just kind of a little bit of background, you know, the old Aragona, where Kemp's Landing originally came from, is a 1957 building. The Old Donation School is a 1965 building, just to kind of put in perspective, you know, 51 years old. So, you know, buildings that are well past their lifetime in terms of how they were built. These two, if you count them as two schools, one project, there are 30th and 31st buildings that we've modernized or replaced over the past 17 or 18 years. And the average age of all those buildings is about 48 years old. Actually, just got this aerial a couple of days ago. Yeah, so the majority of the green roof is on. You know, we've got outdoor learning space for art, similar to what we did at Kellum. But really, it's been a really fascinating building to watch it get built here over the past couple of years. John B. Dye.
First of all, any questions on Old Donation? I mean, you know, this is an opportunity to, if you're, we had the advantage of having toured it 2 or 3 months ago. So
yeah, we're going to take the executive leadership team through third week in October. And, you know, we're going to have probably some sneak peeks, open houses after the first of the year between all the furniture and equipment is on order. It'll start showing up around Thanksgiving, Christmas time, and we'll start doing the move-in after the first of the year. So, you know, if you guys want to get back over there after the first of the year and, you know, see the finished product before we open, we'd be happy to accommodate you.
Is there any potential, if everything falls together nicely, for a semester move-in?
No, sir.
Okay.
5 months early is about as good as we're going to do.
Okay.
All right. John B. Dye Elementary School Modernization. It's a $23.3 million occupied modernization. It's fully funded. Its design is probably closer to 90%. It'll be out on the street, advertised for bid in the next 60 days. If you've been out there, we've actually moved some. We've got 8 portables that we've positioned in anticipation of the project starting. All total, next summer we'll add 12 more, so we'll have a little portable complex, the educational village of 20 portable classrooms out there to facilitate the demo and moving around of an occupied modernization. It's been a while since we've done one of these. If you've driven down there, you've seen we put a turn lane into the main entrance to Great Neck and Great Neck Middle and John B. Dye. Actually, our friends in Public Works funded that through a traffic safety project, so that's done. We've spent a tremendous amount of time talking about parking and traffic circulation. We've had 3 public meetings. We'll likely have one more this spring before we start, where we'll probably introduce our contractor to the community. But I think when all is said and done, we're going to come as close as we can to solving the majority of the traffic circulation issues, bad behavior aside, when we finish out there. This will be our 32nd building we've modernized and replaced, approaching $650 million.
Mr. Arnold, the timeline on this, are you going to get to that as far as, you know, you mentioned, you know, are going to be shifting out into the portables during the year and actually starting during the year?
They're occupying some of the portables now. We'll bid in about 60 days. We'll start construction late winter, early spring. We're going to convert it to a geothermal building. So we'll probably start some of the well drilling this coming winter, spring. We'll have a really heavy first summer in the summer of 17 where we'll get a lot of site work done. And it typically takes us about 27 to 30 months to construct an occupied modernization. So, you know, the late 19, early 20 is when we kind of pull up stakes and get out of there. You know, we did a lot of these back in the early 2000s when we were modernizing buildings. You know, Malibu, Lynn Haven, Trentwood, Kempsville Elementary. You know, there Pembroke Meadows. There's sprinkled around the city, it's good work. The market is much better. People were not attracted to this work when the market was in a much different place. But it's good work, but it's tough work. You know, construction and education don't mix well. We safety first and foremost. We know how to do this, but it's a difficult project, and that's why, you know, you can build an elementary school in 15 months. You cannot modernize an occupied building in that amount of time. It takes 24, 27, sometimes up to 30 months. Yes, ma'am.
That part that I see on the back. That's kind of like a lighter part. Mm-hmm. Is that kind of a newer part that you're building on, adding
yes,
on to?
Yes, ma'am. You're looking, this is the bird's eye view is actually kind of from the Great Neck Road vantage point.
Right.
And the front of the building is going to shift from Great Neck Road towards the main entrance road, kind of facing Great Neck Middle School. We're going to tear down the old gym. We're going to build a new gym, new cafeteria. We'll put the library and media center in the old cafeteria. So, you know, it's a mix of demolition, new construction, modernizing old wings, you know, where we'll move kids out into the portable classrooms. You know, that's how we free space up when we do this. You know, it's a very complicated phasing construction project. That's why it takes so long. You'll see a mix of demo, new construction, and major renovation. You know, there's not a space inside and out that we don't touch.
Okay.
Is the timeline on the gyms going to leave them without a gym for part of the timeline?
We're still working through the exact phasing. We try not to do that for that reason. And then when we do it, we try to do it in a season where they can be outside. I'll have to look at the exact phasing.
You know, it's kind of hard to do the site work without that gym sitting there.
Right.
Yeah. Okay.
And just an interior rendering this is actually a learning commons / extended learning area. All of the grade levels have one of these extended learning areas. Flexible space with classrooms around them. Folks, this is really the first traditional K-5 elementary school where we've brought 21st century learning into the programming and design. You'll see it in ODS in a 2-8 environment, but this is the first K-5 elementary school. Mike Ross at HBA did a really great job programming this thing. Was tough. Trying to accomplish these types of spaces, working within the confines of an existing structure, is challenging. Thurgood, I'll talk to you a little bit. Thurgood's the next one where you start with a blank slate. It's much easier. But you're going to see great examples in this building of flexible 21st century learning spaces where you can get groups, get kids together in small groups, grade levels, things like that. Moving on to all of our summer infrastructure work, we re-roofed Salem High School and did some HVAC work over the past two summers. Last summer we did the admin classrooms in the auditorium. This summer did the cafeteria, gymnasium, and locker rooms. About $4.25 million. Project substantially complete. That building's a 1989 building, one of the buildings that was opened about the time that I came here. So I was 27 years old, obviously in need of a roof. Matt Delaney, you know, being involved in a roofing and an HVAC project is not a fun thing if you're a user. You need a dry building, you need a cool building. But we've had a good customer there. He's been very flexible. So we're just finishing up punch list stuff, doing some commissioning and balancing some of the HVAC work. But contractor did a good job for us. Similar base at middle school, re-roofed that entire 1969 building. It's the second time it's got a roof. We re-roofed it in 1990. So that roof's 25 years old, about a $3 million project. Last summer we did the auditorium, gymnasiums, and 600 hall. This past summer we had to move Paul out of the admin. We did admin, library, cafeteria, and the 300 and 400 halls. I can't say enough. This has got nothing to do with construction, but what Paul and those folks do over there each and every day. Marshall Everett, one of our inspectors who was over at Kellen, has been over at Bayside Middle School, and we do our best to try to stay out of their way. They've really got you get your money's worth out of those folks over there each and every day. Lynn Haven Middle School, HVAC equipment, multi-zone rooftop equipment replacement, about $2.5 million project is finished. That's a 1974 building, 42 years old. Contractor did a good job, and so we're punching it out and doing the balancing and commissioning. And that's, you go into these older buildings, and I don't care what type of work you're doing, it's just like a house, folks. You find stuff, you find things weren't built back then the way they are today, and so you find some interesting construction details. And so we'll spend the better part of the fall in some of these projects doing balancing, commissioning, and making sure that before we leave, things are operating properly. Plaza Middle School, similar, $1.75 million. HVAC multi-zone, that's my junior high school, 1969, 47 years old. It's very similar to the Lynn Haven Middle School project. Contractor did a good job, project's done, and we're just doing balancing and commissioning. Kempsville Middle School, we had a little bit of HVAC work left to do. We touched this building last summer. Here's a good example of when you have funding limitations, you end up touching a building multiple times because of funding restrictions. It's not the best way to do business. And so here's an example where we touched this building last summer. Schools like it because sometimes it allows them to get out of summer school. We don't like it because you keep your shovel back up and touching the house. So we did some HVAC work, small project, it's finished. I didn't pay attention to this until today, but it's also a 1969 building that's 47 years old. So it opened the same year as Plaza Middle. And Kempsville Middle is the same footprint as the old Kellum, Kempsville High, Bayside, and First Colonial. And so it's interesting that that Plaza, and at the time, a pretty state-of-the-art cutting edge. It had Kivas, the planetarium, so they got that really interesting, great building. And Kempsville got is really a high school footprint. Woodstock and Hermitage Elementary Schools, chiller replacements, not exciting, but you've got to do these things. Woodstock's an 02, 14 years old. Hermitage is 05, 11 years old. Those are both early users of the prototype plan. But again, real money, folks. $750,000. You got to keep these systems up and running. Project went well. Kempsville High School bleacher replacement. Dr. Spence and Dr. Bergen, I'll show you a picture in a second. We do this for a living, and so we just keep marching on and go through this thing. And I was telling Doc that, that this project, a simple little project, really changed the complexion of the gymnasium. It's a $400,000 project, and the bleachers were old. Wow. But if you go in there, we refinished the gym floor, and it's so the gymnasium looks, it's a great space. It really, it makes a huge difference. They've it's our first wireless scoring table. Scoring table comes with the bleachers, so you know, it's a little pop of color. They get their letters on the bleachers, and so you know, it's a heck of a lot more exciting than a HVAC rooftop.
He asked if he should put pictures of those, and I said, I don't think I'll want to see those.
You know, even for a Kellum guy to go into enemy territory, it's and you know, we're going back. We're designing the Entrepreneurial Academy project right now. Kempsville's also got a locker project. We're not going to put 2,000 lockers back. We're learning a lot from Kellum about lockers and locker usage and size of lockers, and so we're combining those two projects. But that project will be out at the end of the year. So for the next two summers, we'll be back over at Kempsville, primarily back in what I call the old shop area, turning that into the Entrepreneurial Academy. The renovations to the Renaissance Academy, we're moving the Adult Learning Center over there at the end of the year, $750,000 project. The interior work, and I'll show you a picture in a second, it's almost finished. We should be done in about another 2 or 3 weeks. The park, two separate parking lots, one on the front up by Wichtuck is done. The one on the back where the old ropes course used to be is about halfway done. We should be finished up late October, early November. We're going to talk about the disposition of the Adult Learning Center a little bit later, but you know, I was going back through my notes, and you know, let's not lose sight of the fact that one of the reasons we did this is, you know, we're going to save about $220,000 annually in O&M costs by getting out from the Adult Learning Center building. I mean, that's not even touching any potential HR, you know, kind of admin support staff costs that might come, savings that might come down the road. But, you know, so it's an operational savings. It's, we think, a better way of doing business, use a building that's got space, and get out from underneath the building that I've long questioned why we bought it. But that's a story for another day. Just an interior shot of, you know, it's a minimal improvements inside. We're setting up some office space to accommodate Paul Palumbo and his staff from the Adult Learning Center, who are going to move over in December and January. We'll have a move meeting in October. Eric Woodhouse and our supply folks are Mayflower movers. You know, every one of these buildings that requires a move, we do it all internally. Again, a lot of the things that operationally that this division does day in and day out, that people don't see, but picking up, you know, this is an easy move. Picking up and moving the ODS program is no easy task, and we do it pretty seamlessly. The canopy repair, you know, believe it or not, Ocean Lakes is 22 years old. I still think to me, that's a building that was ahead of its time. It's been a shame that it's kind of tucked back in next to the treatment plant. And it's hard, you know, it's hard to get to. But it's, you know, that building is still one of my favorite buildings. You know, a building with a lot of natural light, and you know, you walk into the building, it has an open airy feeling, and it's really a great building that I think will be around for a really, really long time. We've had some long standing issues with the canopies and some internal drains and them filling up with water and freezing and thawing, and so we have finally solved that problem, and there's a picture of the front entry canopy. Steel guys struggled a little bit, but they're buttoning up over there, and they were out of the way for the first day of school. We own 2,000 acres of real estate, and so if you think about that, and roughly 90 sites and all the parking lots and all the fences and all the drainage and all the stuff that on the outside that's subjected to the elements, it gets old just like the stuff on the inside. And so we do $750,000, $800,000 worth of parking lot improvements. If you go to Ocean Lakes, you'll see we finished the last half of all the parking lots this summer. So the parking lots are done. We did a little bit out in front of Prince Anne High School. Unfortunately, we're pushing water around, I think, in an old place. You got a new principal over there who's walked into an interesting building, great building, but there's some interesting parts of that building.
There's simply parts.
We did the basketball courts over at Point of View Elementary School. We do about 12, 14, 15 million in infrastructure asset work every summer in 70 days. And the key to that is being the first school division out. We've gotten much better. Next summer's work is already designed. It's being worked on. We sometimes work two summers in advance so that we're first one out. We get it out of the street, Thanksgiving, Christmas, January. If you're playing in the school market and trying to do summer work and you're waiting until April and May, it's good luck getting mechanical equipment. So it's that's how we get good pricing, get the best contractors, and we had a really, really good summer in terms of folks finishing stuff on time. But setting up the people who do work for us to be successful, it makes a big difference. Okay. Thurgood is on your agenda tonight to hire Via Design Architects. It's our next elementary school replacement. It'll be number 33. I think it's the 25th elementary school we will have done. Donna Fanniff at Via Design did Shelton Park, Trentwood, and the Newtown replacement. Great architect. In fact, we met with Cheryl Zigrang yesterday to talk about starting this project. We'll start the programming here fairly soon. We don't have an exact schedule yet. That's why we're talking about design start. You know, we've got to get in there and figure out the best way to do this thing. But that's one of the old, what we call the three finger plans, that it makes absolute sense to build a new building there. PA Middle School replacement, again on your agenda, RRMM Architects. They've done Luxburg, Kempsville Meadows, Renaissance, Old Donation School, top shelf folks. You'll see that at ODS. We've got a meeting on Monday with Alex Bergman to start that conversation. It's a 1962 building. I forgot to mention, Thurgood is a 1958 building, so it's 58 years old. So it'll be, by the time we get to it, get done, it'll be about 60 years old. PA Middle is 1962, 54 years old. That'll be our 34th building, about $750 million in replacing and modernizing our old assets. If you stop at PA Middle, we will have modernized or replaced 3.8 million square feet of space, or about 36% of our assets in the last 18-19 years. So, you know, we're Mark Bergen was talking about, you know, how coming in here, you know, how fortunate we are to be able to, you know, there aren't any divisions regionally who have been as fortunate as we've been over the past couple of decades to be able to take care of some of these older buildings. We've got a lot to be thankful for. But, you cannot relax when you've got 11 million square feet of space and you've got nearly 90 buildings. You've got to keep it up. We had a good budget year on the capital side of the house this past year. We've got about $61 million in 16-17. We've got about $54 million program for next year. So, you know, we kind of turned the corner. That's allowed us to get rolling. You know, finish up design on Dye, get rolling on Thurgood and PA Middle School. That compared to the average over the last 6 years, which is about $35 million. You can't maintain the infrastructure of this division on $30-35 million. You can't do it. You can't keep up. You know, so we feel like we've turned the corner. We've got another $15 million in energy performance contracts that's on your agenda tonight, where we're going to go back in and pick up some of the older buildings, improve energy there, and I think probably more importantly, going into some of these classrooms that have got 1980s T12 bulbs where it's like a cave. My wife is in one of those schools. LED lighting is in ODS, and it's going to be in some of these older buildings that we're going to get to over the course of the next 2 or 3 years. We still have a lot of work to do. And so, you know, we've got a lot to be thankful for, but we've got 25 school buildings for about 3 million square feet of our space that was built in the 50s, 60s, and 70s that we have not gotten to. And our four oldest high schools, Princeton, Kempsville, Bayside, First Colonial, in 2020, the average age will be 58 years old. And Princeton will be, which is the next high school, will be 66. So that completes my report, Mr. Chairman.
Okay, any questions? Confirming one thing, Thorogood's a replacement.
Yes, sir.
So there's a swing school involved?
No, not? No.
We are, there are two ways to do it. And we've done it multiple ways. There are four ways to do it.
Right. Okay, give us the Reader's Digest. To be determined, then that's okay.
To be determined.
Okay. Other questions? Ms. Taylor?
This isn't a question, but I just wanted to commend Mr. Arnold and Mr. Holman for this. You don't know, as a former principal who sat at John B. Dye when they had their last modernization back in the early 90s, it went so smoothly. Mr. Holt's predecessor, John Calicay, we had a hurricane the Friday before school was supposed to open. I had no ceiling tiles in the entire building of John B. Dye. By Monday, we were ready to open. We worked on Monday because the store had been closed and all that. But they make it happen. And it really is relatively a calm way to do it. Mr. Arnold makes sure everything stays calm, and you just go with the flow, and it gets done. And you know, as a principal who's gone through it, that's a principal's worst nightmare, is modernization. It isn't that way. It goes wonderfully well. They have it all planned. Mr. Holt's people move things numerous times. We went through a whole year without a library at John B. Dye. And I thought the parents, and no place to have recess. And I thought the first day the parents marching on me in July, I was going to be out of a job. But anyway, I also want to commend the principals that go through that, because they are the ones, they're the first liaison to their teachers and their parents, and the calmer they stay, the better off the job goes. But anyway, I just want to say thank you again.
Thank you.
You all do a wonderful job.
For a principal, it's like having a second job.
It really is.
All right, we're going to obviously do the quarterly forecast after the meeting, not now. Since really that is an administrative, not a policy, or we don't make substantive decisions, we simply schedule things. Is everybody okay with leaving that off camera, and we'll just do it 1/13 on the front end of the close? Is that all right with everybody?
For the what?
For the quarterly forecast.
Oh, yeah.
All right.
There were a couple questions for Tony.
Oh, I'm sorry. More questions for Tony.
Tony.
I'm sorry.
Ms. McLeod and then right. Me.
Mine was a quick question.
Yes, ma'am.
And actually was tagging, I'll just tag on the kudos. The question I have is Thorogood, are we increasing capacity there?
I looked at the enrollment. It's 720, 30. So short answer is yes.
Okay.
What we've historically done is we don't build to the child. We try to put some flexibility in terms of the capacity so that they've got a little room to...
That area is in a circle of lifetime.
Right.
So, and the other thing I just wanted to mention to colleagues was that being with Tony on the Facility Steering Committee, it was what got me involved. And we said back then, and our recommendation to the then school board was, if you're only investing 60-some million dollars a year, you're never ever going to get done. The recommendation was that you spend $100 million and you get done in 30 years. Well, obviously, we're still... But so he does a great job with the money he's given, and we're grateful for it. So.
Great. And I just have a real brief question also. You spoke just a little bit about the energy performance things that are getting ready to be happening. Can you just give us a little bit of savings that we get, for example, changing the LED to LED lights, for example? Can you give me a little bit of that real quick?
Well, I can tell you, we've done $14.1 million to date. All right, the next round is 15 million, and we're saving annually about 1.8 million based on the 14.1 we've already spent. So
if you've got some project details on stuff, if you could send that out to the board, that would be really useful.
Sure.
Intro.
Yeah. Have to do it. So Jim really does a great job. Jim will be here to speak to that project. We'll send you some information about that.
Okay.
About what we've done.
Especially on those energy saving details. Sure. I'd like to have some of those if you send those out.
Yep.
Thank you.
All right, we are in recess to reconvene at 6:20 minutes from now in the boardroom.